Jonny Bones Jones has dominated the pound-for-pound rankings for years, and is considered by many to be the greatest MMA fighter of all time. With a combination of unorthodox techniques and incredible athleticism, Jones has overcome every challenge set in front of him so far, and completely cleaned out the 205-pound division. Much of his success can be attributed to his grappling skills. And now that he could possibly be making his heavyweight debut soon, with bigger and stronger grapplers in their own right, many are wondering if John's skills will translate well to this new division. It raises the question, how good is John Jones's grappling? What is going on, everybody? Welcome to the Fight Dialogue. My name is Tim. So as voted on by you guys, I'm going to be doing a detailed breakdown of John Jones's grappling skills. In order to do that, I'm going to look at six key elements of grappling as they relate to the sport of MMA. For each category, I give a score based on a scale from 1 to 10. Then at the end of the video, I take the average of those scores to give an overall grade. I base these scores off my own observations of their most recent fights of relevance and the quality of the opponents that they have faced. Since every fight begins standing, let's start with John's takedown defense. Despite his reputation for being an excellent grappler, it hasn't stopped many of his opponents from trying their luck against his grappling skills. From his earliest fights all the way to his more recent fights, guys have tried to take John Jones down with very little success. His Greco-Roman wrestling background has served him extremely well in this regard, but his body type provides him several advantages as well. Because of his reach and mastery of distance management, fighters have a very difficult time getting in close enough to grab him. The threat of his striking is something that gives many of his opponents pause. His down blocks and stiff arms do a great job of thwarting the faster and longer range attempts. If they do get a hold of him, Jones has strong balance and an excellent sprawl. He oftentimes threatens with reversals from seemingly compromised positions, and he knows how to use the cage to his advantage when trying to keep his balance. From the clinch in open space, he does a fantastic job of keeping his hips out of range of his opponents and distracts them with various knees, elbows, and shoulder strikes. I think the one thing that must be noted about John's takedown defense is the amount of elite grapplers that have tried to get him down. High-level collegiate and even Olympic-level wrestlers have either failed miserably attempting to ground him, or wasted so much time and energy in the attempt that it was hardly worth it. He was taken down once by Alexander Gustafsson in their fight, twice if you count this one. Regardless of John's questionable preparation or the lack thereof for that fight, I think this showed two potential weaknesses in John's takedown defense. The first being that John can be lulled into a false sense of security. I don't think anyone was expecting the mauler to even attempt a takedown, let alone finish one, and it was apparent that Jones didn't either. The second potential weakness is that Jones may have a hard time defending takedowns against guys that are of comparable size or bigger, something that doesn't exactly bode well for his heavyweight aspirations. Alex was one of the biggest men he has fought, and I think that played a part in the success of that takedown. Despite this, I can count on one hand how many times Jones has been put on the floor involuntarily. And when you can boast that type of defense against the likes of Ryan Bader, Rashad Evans, and Daniel Cormier, it deserves a score of no less than 9.75 for takedown defense. Next category to discuss is ground and pound defense. This is where I warn you guys to take this part of the analysis with a huge grain of salt, because after watching every single one of John's fights, he has spent less than 20 seconds on the ground with an opponent on top of him, which is where most of ground and pound defense comes into effect. This forces me to do a lot of guesswork in regards to his skill set. So first and foremost, if you can avoid ever being on your back, that is a passive but extremely effective means to negate ground and pound. But as we discussed, it is extremely difficult to take John Jones down, but it isn't impossible, especially for bigger guys. So how would he fare defensively with a heavyweight on top of him? The only real examples I have of Jones in this type of scenario was when he pulled guard against Daniel Cormier and Rashad Evans. Both were in the last 10 seconds or so of a round, and when he pulled guard against DC, he was moving around in such a way that Cormier wasn't able to settle himself down into position to throw. Being hard to control on the ground is something that complements John Jones's ground and pound defense. The other example is a little bit more interesting because, unlike the last, Rashad was able to position himself to throw a flurry of potentially damaging strikes. John made great use of his long arms to frame against Rashad's punches, while also maneuvering his upper body and hips to move with them to lessen their effectiveness. Rashad was down on the scorecards and swinging to end the fight, but I don't think any of the strikes landed cleanly, so kudos to Jones. But again, both of these examples were very brief exchanges, so it doesn't quite tell us everything we need to know. When we look at the strikes that have been landed against John while he is in the top position, we can see that he does a good job of controlling his opponent's movement and stops any kind of angle change that would potentially give them the leverage to land a damaging strike from the bottom. Not enough people put stock in that type of ground and pound defense, but considering the amount of horrendous cuts that have occurred as a result of short strikes such as elbows, which can be applied from the bottom position, it's something I try to take note of when I look at ground and pound defense. On that note, however, John has taken a couple significant upkicks in his career, so that's something that he needs to watch out for. When I try to speculate on other potential ground and pound defense skills he may possess, I know that he has a purple belt in jiu-jitsu, and the length of his limbs provide him many advantages from the guard position. Throwing up submissions is a good way of deterring ground and pound. That all changes when the guard is passed, though. So the biggest question to be answered here is, how can Jones defend against strikes in a truly disadvantageous position? And unfortunately, I can't answer that with any real certainty. I ran into a similar problem when I analyzed Khabib's ground and pound defense. I gave Khabib the score of 8 out of 10 and was nearly run out of town by you guys, because even though I believe he does have the skills to defend off his back, I had never seen him put in that type of situation, so I couldn't give him a perfect score. I base these scores off what I have actually observed, not what I imagine their skills to be. For these same reasons, I'm going to give John Jones a similar score, but because Jones fought far more accomplished grapplers throughout his career and had similar results, I'm going to give him the score of 8.5 for ground and pound defense. The last element to cover for defense is John's submission defense. Throughout Johnny's career, he has had several fighters attempt to submit him. The vast majority of them did not even remotely threaten him. Various choke attempts and even a leg lock entry attempt from Shogun fell apart pretty much as soon as they were applied. Except if you count this triangle. Although, I don't think Vitor would have gotten it if Jones wasn't being a little riskier with his arm positioning due to it being the last few seconds of a round. The one and only example of Jones having to escape a submission in earnest was an armbar attempt from Vitor Belfort. In that attempt, Jones was raining down punches and elbows from within Vitor's guard. He was sort of doing what is known as a can opener to Belfort, which is a type of neck crank that forces a person to open their guard. One of the counters to this is an armbar, and Vitor applied it quickly and viciously. Jones immediately grabbed his own arm and tried to posture out, but to be honest, that wasn't the best idea. Oftentimes when you're trying to posture out of an armbar, it just makes your arm go more straight and therefore become more vulnerable. That's pretty much exactly what happened, and Belfort had Jones dead to rights in this lock. According to Vitor, the only reason Jones managed to escape was because Vitor heard the arm pop and let go of it just a little bit, thinking he had snapped it, which allowed Jones just enough wiggle room to get his arm back and ultimately escape. Jones would later confirm this and said that he was just going to let it snap, and even that his arm felt numb afterwards. His toughness is admirable, and even though this is just one example of Jones being in danger on the ground, it tells us quite a few things. First is that one of Jones' preferred methods of opening his opponent's guard is somewhat easy to counter for anyone that's good off their back. And even though he managed to stay safe from the armbar for the rest of the fight, he kept going back to that can opener. Whether or not it's because he just likes to live a little dangerously, or he was just ignorant to how he even got armbarred in the first place, I can't quite say. The fact that his first thought was to try to pull out of the armbar instead of using a more reliable defense may be indicative of his knowledge of armbar escapes. I think it's also worth noting that even though there are many pros to having longer limbs as a grappler, there are some cons. Having longer limbs gives more for your opponent to hold onto and trap. So in this way, John could have some issues against someone with not just decent arm locks, but leg locks as well. To conclude this category, the fact that Jones has spent quite a long time within the guard of his opponents and only been put in a bad spot once does suggest that he has great submission awareness. I think until the day someone puts him on his back or takes his back, he should be safe from most submission threats, especially since there aren't many high-level guard players in the UFC's heavyweight division anymore that could really give him much trouble. So for submission defense, he will receive an 8.5. Now I get to the part of the video where we get to talk about Johnny's offensive skills. let's go over takedown offense. As previously mentioned, Jones has strong Greco-Roman wrestling, and this is clearly on display in his early career. High amplitude throws and slams were his preferred method of grounding his opponents. As his career progressed and he began to face opponents with better defense, John started using a more varied method of attack, using trips, tackles, and the cage to take down his foes. The execution and just the overall well-roundedness of his technique is something that is very impressive, especially amongst the heavier weight classes. Being as tall as he is, he's going to be more familiar than most with the use of overhooks. From what I've seen, I don't know if there is anyone that uses them better than him, honestly. His propensity to attack in so many different ways with overhooks is uncommon in MMA. The other thing that makes Jones stand out, especially in the context of takedowns for MMA, is his ability to utilize a skill that GSP refers to as shoot boxing. This is basically setting up your takedowns with some form of striking, or vice versa. Jones was one of the first fighters in MMA to utilize the shoulder strike from the clinch. This isn't the most devastating strike, but it is very distracting and helps to set up his upper body throws. Another striking technique that helps set up his takedowns is the spinning elbow. John will duck down, making it look like he's about to shoot for a double. Then, when the hands of his opponents drop to block the takedown, he spins into the elbow. This is more of a compliment to his striking setups, but it can help him set up his takedowns after a successful spinning elbow, because now his opponents are more wary of the elbow than they are of the takedown. My biggest critique of John's takedown offense is the fact that he uses it somewhat inconsistently in his fights. This may be because his last few opponents were notably taller and gave him difficulties. Or it could just be that he wants to try to showcase his striking more. It's hard to know for sure. His tendency to be generally more conservative in his recent fights is something that for the most part manifests as a lack of takedown offense. And whether he's at range, against the fence, or in the clinch, his willingness to go for takedowns definitely seems more subdued than when he first entered the UFC. But based on everything I've seen from then until now, I know that he possesses all the techniques to be considered an elite level wrestler in the context of MMA. So for takedown offense, he will receive a 9.5. Next is ground and pound offense. This is the area I believe John Jones excels the most in. When we look at John's ability to grapple box, there is one thing about him that truly stands out above all others. John's elbows from the top position are insanely OP. Jones is known for his elbows in a stand-up battle as well, but I think the place that they are most effective from is on the ground. I'm not sure if the crazy reach advantage he has over everybody plays a factor here, but from a technical standpoint, he is above and beyond everyone else in this department. He fires off sharp and devastating elbows from every and any angle, from multiple positions. More often than not, he will land a majority of his elbows from within opponents' guards, especially if they try to utilize double or single wrist control. When they do that, Jones simply lets them and rolls his elbow into their face while keeping his wrist right where they wanted it. Elbows certainly aren't his only ground and pound weapons. Johnny isn't shy when it comes to slamming down some good old-fashioned punches. He's knowledgeable in the art of pinning his opponents on the ground and against the cage in order to land strikes. And if he has you hurt, his natural killer instinct has always gotten the job done. The one position I would say that you absolutely do not want Jones to transition to is the mounted crucifix. That's kind of a given for any MMA fight really, but especially for John Jones. It's a kill zone that Jones has found several times in his career, and each time it was a wrap once he got it there. The only negative thing I can really say about his ground and pound offense is that sometimes he gives his opponents a little bit too much space and doesn't smother them enough. The craftier grapplers of the light heavyweight division have been able to escape his control when given just a little bit of space, and there's been a few times where Jones has started swinging wildly with little to no control over the person at all. Besides that, Jones' ground and pound is top tier, and his numerous finishes using this method speak to that. So I can't give him anything less than a 9.75 for this category. Last but not least is John's submission offense. Jones has a total of 6 wins to date via submission, 4 of which are guillotine chokes. This is clearly a go-to move for Jones, but unlike many guillotine artists, John Jones doesn't jump or pull guard as he applies it. All of his guillotine wins have come from the top or standing positions. I'm sure he's capable of applying it from his guard, he just prefers not to, which is kind of unique. Jones has an uncanny ability to get his opponents into front headlock positions, even when things get chaotic. His height may play a factor in this. After all, when you're almost a head taller than most of your opponents, it doesn't take all that much to reach over their head and grab their neck. In addition to his knack for finding this choke, he also has a knack for using the modified or high elbow versions of it, which is something that plays off his long limbs perfectly. He has showed some diversity in his submissions by winning by rear naked choke over Rampage Jackson and Americana versus Belfort. We haven't seen John Jones really go for any other type of joint locks besides that Americana though. We have seen Jones go for the mirror lock several times from the standing position, but that's basically just another version of the Americana. He wasn't able to get the win with them either, but that's kind of a weird one, because when applied brutally and quickly like Jones did here, the guy doesn't really have enough time to tap. You either break the guy's arm and win the fight, or he toughs it out and the fight continues. But it's definitely worth noting here, because I know in the fight with Glover Teixeira, he damaged Glover's arm and shoulder, and it probably affected the outcome of the fight in some way. Based on his good submission awareness, I can say with confidence that he probably understands the fundamental mechanics of most common types of joint locks. He just hasn't really showed us that part of his game yet. I have to take some points away for that, but based on his success rate with chokes and the overall cold efficiency of his submission wins, I'll give him an 8.75 out of 10 for submission offense. When the scores are tallied up and I get the average, it gives John Bones Jones the overall score of about 9.1. This is tied for the best score I've given to date. And just like with my video about Khabib's grappling, I wish I had more examples of his defensive ground and pound skills to go off of in order to give a more detailed and accurate score. I'm hoping that sometime in the future, Jones will fight someone that puts him on his back or in more vulnerable spots so that we can truly see what he can do. If so, I will of course adjust his scores. All controversies aside, John Jones is on a technical level the best fighter I've ever analyzed. The fact that he was destroying high-level grapplers in the UFC with less than a year of MMA training is just unheard of. And on paper, I don't think there's been anyone who has faced the crazy amount of elite-level grapplers that he has in the sport. I look forward to seeing where he goes from here in his career. So that pretty much does it for this episode of How Good Is Their Grappling. Make sure to stick around to the end and you can see the scores that I've given for everybody else. If you want to support the channel, I got a link up top that you can use and a link in the description. You can get early access and there's a lot of exclusive content on there that I think you guys might enjoy. Of course, it helps the channel out a lot and helps me make more videos like this. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Make sure to like and subscribe as always, and take care.